Remain standing for our first song, The Star Spangled Banner.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallant
Christian soldiers. We are celebrating, of course, the birthday of our country this last week, but where is the main person that we are serving? On the job, in your life, everything, it's Christ whom we're a soldier for.
Church of God, brothers, we are
have seen the glory. The Battle Hymn of the Republic.
How many of you like birthday parties? You like a birthday party? You get a candle on your cake? I got just one candle here. You know, we just had the birthday of our country last Thursday. Our country was 248 years old. I didn't have that many candles, so that's why I just brought one. You know, our country has a birthday, but did you know that you can have two birthdays? Did you know that? Yeah. Jesus told somebody, asked him one time, And he said to the person, to the man, he said that you must be born again. You can be born by flesh and blood, in other words, born just with your body. That's the birthday that we normally celebrate. But Jesus said you have to be born again. That means you have a second birthday. When you ask Jesus to come into your heart, you're born again. So that means you have a second birthday. And that second birthday is very special because that second birthday means you get to live forever with Jesus. Isn't that neat? We'll have birthday parties in heaven forever. Can you imagine how many candles you're going to have? Wow, that'd be a lot of candles sometimes up there, won't it? Yes. So next time you have a birthday and blow it out, remember, we all want to have that second birthday, don't we? And that's a very special one. Let's fold our hands and close our eyes. Jesus, thank you for giving us a second birthday, giving us a second chance to live forever with you. We pray for our moms and dads that you would help them to train us and guide us. We pray for our pastor that you would give him words. We pray for these little ones, Lord, that they will accept that second birthday from you, the free gift you offer. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
So here's your challenge for the week. Search for God in everything. You'll be amazed where you'll find him.
Stand for our last song, My Country, 'Tis of Thee.
Well, I decided I wanted to do this song. It's about freedom in a different type of nature. So It's an old song, so if you've heard it, you can sing with me, but it's If You Believe. I read about how Paul and Silas were in jail. There was no one, nobody there to go their bail. But when they prayed, they found that God was on their side. The jailhouse door swung open wide. If you believe, you shall receive. There's not a trouble or care the good Lord can't relieve. Oh, He is just the same today. All you gotta do is trust and pray, believe. You must believe. When David stood before that giant with his sling, Goliath laughed at such a puny little thing. But David knew his faith in God would stand the test. He threw the rock. God did the
playing now. Okay, see, getting the nursery together. Children's church goes this way. And the rest of you are stuck with me. Turn with me this morning to the Gospel of John, chapter 8. We're going to talk about the chain of events that happens in life that leads up to things, and then we'll move on to what things lead to. We all know July 4th is Independence Day, but somewhere along the line I made myself a couple of little notes. The first skirmish of the Revolutionary War was in 1770, 6 years before the signing of the Declaration, the Boston Massacre, when people were shot for standing up and saying we're not going to pay taxes. 1773, everybody knows what the Boston Tea Party was. It's just a set of events that keep leading up further and further. I've got a note for myself here that 92,000 pounds of tea was dumped into the Boston Harbor. That's a lot of tea. Yeah. I drink coffee because I got it figured that our nation spent a lot of time dumping tea out, so I'm patriotic and I drink coffee instead. That's just me. I'm just giving you information there. 1775, almost a year and a half before the Declaration of Independence, was the battles of Lexington and Concord. They were already fighting battles against the British. Everything kept leading up. And you know what really was happening the entire time from 1763 until 1776? They were trying to get along. Everybody just, well, let's just get along. We'll just stop this one more thing. Now, I'm saying that for a purpose, I promise. And then 1776... the Declaration of Independence was presented and voted on July 2nd. Everybody thinks the 4th. July 2nd, John Hancock was the only one signed it. He signed it great big. Then they had to go bring everybody else in, and everybody else showed up and signed it on July 4th. That's why we celebrate July 4th. We got to declare that we're separate from something because things didn't work out. Okay, Now, I say all that to say this. At what point in time in our lives is there a chain of events that makes us think God led us here? Stop and think about that. I'll just say this, and for those of you who know my family, you'll understand a little bit about it, but Charlotte and I are married because of a chain of events that involved a couple of little old ladies being mad at the preacher. Not a joke, and I guarantee you some of you know the little old ladies. They were mad at the preacher. It's a whole ordeal. Charlotte's dad, my father-in-law, came, and then Charlotte came with her, and I met because of a church fight. Isn't that odd? See, I'm going to tell you right now, no matter what the problems in your life have been, no matter what's came up through the years, there's a chain of events that's led you to here. Is there anything you can do about what was before? You cannot go back. We talked in Sunday school a little bit this morning. Time only goes one direction. It goes forward. And how many people want to go to the past? Don't work that way. Okay, now, let me move on with my sermon now. How about that? That was all just for free. Verse 31, John 8:31. I guarantee you, most of you, if you've been in church a half a dozen times, you've heard these verses. If you haven't been in church, you probably still have heard parts of it. Then Jesus said to those Jews which believed on Him, "If you continue in My word, then you are My disciples indeed. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." What is the truth? Isn't that what Pilate asked? Pilate asked that to Jesus. Jesus said He was the truth. What is the truth? That's a funny question. Because what is the truth? Jesus Christ. Our Bible school this year, we learned, what is it that never changes? The truth of God's Word. It never changes. The truth is the same. Now, if anybody here were in the middle of Independence Day weekend, and man, we're in the middle of all these elections, is anybody else here tired of the elections already and we're still 4 months away? Do you think you're hearing truth out of any of them people? If you do, you're silly. I'm sorry. I'm just going to apologize in advance. I don't think you got good sense if you think any of them people's telling you the truth. The truth comes from God's Word, and I ain't heard none of them quote it yet. And when they quote it wrong. The truth is that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Amen. That's the truth. That never changes. Now, what you get is, you get Him going on here, and He says, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." They answered and they said, "But we be Abraham's seed. We were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, you shall make, we're going to be free?" Man, I was born an American. That's kind of what they're saying here. We're born free. Guess what? We're born into a sinful world. That's where we were born. They seen it just the same as we do. People all the time with this, "Well, I'm an American." Do you think for 1 second that, I'm going to be careful what I say because I'm going to go into the weeds, Donna, and that's not going to be good, is it? For some people it would be, but for some it won't. We go to Orlando every so often, and we go to Disney and Universal and all this, and you can buy these things called a Fast Pass. And that means that they have these lines that just go from here to the highway and back and back, and you walk and you stand and you walk and you stand. But you get this Fast Pass. Pay a fortune for the thing. It gets you to the front of the line. They have a line over to the side that says Fast Pass. Anybody ever been there? You walk up, you take your Fast Pass, you walk up there and you beep that thing and you go to the front of the line. Isn't that amazing how that works? I have no idea what it has to do with my sermon. See, that's what I get for getting in the weeds. I got right in the middle of that and I thought, what does that even have to do with this sermon? But what I'm actually trying to say to you is there's a line. There's not going to be a line in heaven that says Fast Pass. There's going to be a line, and it's going to be every person who's ever drawn breath. And we have people who believe that, well, if I'm an American, there's going to be a separate line. They really do. They think if I'm a Baptist, there's going to be a separate line. I'm afraid the Baptist line is going to go the other direction. I'm just not 100% positive. But so you got on here and he says, we're Abraham's seed. We ain't never been in bondage. Folks, if you're here and you know what sin is, you've been in bondage. If you're here and you're saved, you've been in bondage. Because that's what he's going to go on and say. And Jesus answered them and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever commits sin is a servant of sin. So you have been in bondage. We have. Don't say you haven't. Because if you've ever sinned, you've been a servant of sin. And we've all fell short of the glory of God. And the servant abides not in the house forever. That's a good one. So whenever you serve something else, you don't get to stay. You go and you work. I know Joey and Tony, whenever they worked their way through college, and they were both, 1 year, they were both at Hank's Fine Furniture at the same time. Anybody ever heard, see those commercials? Hank's Fine Furniture. Well, my boys worked their way through college delivering furniture for Hank. They went down to Branson one day, and they called me. They were amazed. They took a whole truckload, tens of thousands, if not more, in furniture. Haul it down to Branson to this huge mansion. And go in there, and they were taking pictures going in. This is the most amazing place. The guy bought the most expensive furniture. They're carrying it up these spiral staircases. It's amazing. We got all this stuff. And I don't have a clue what that has to do with my sermon either. It's been a long week. But anyway, nah, that's a joke, I really do. The servant, they went, guess how long they got to stay? Long enough to deliver the furniture. They didn't stay. While they were doing it, they found out the person that owns it, his name was Duncan. He was a pitching coach for the St. Louis Cardinals. They managed to get an autograph. That's it. And then all of his family rolled in to see the new house. Guess who got to stay and who had to leave? The people that were delivering furniture are out. Right? Oh, come on. Don't you love it when people just hang around your house for no reason? See, that's how people do. We think because we come to church once in a while, we're going to have a home in heaven. That ain't got anything to do with it. The truth makes us free. And the truth is that Jesus Christ died for our sins. Amen. The truth is that we have to turn that over to Him. That brings us a home in heaven. Then in the next line it says, but the Son abides forever. See, servants, they can come and go. They do their job and they move on. But folks, the Son stays. It's His. He inherits it. See, we become sons of God. Jesus Christ was the Son of God, and we become joint heirs. So all at once, if you're here and you know Jesus as Savior, not only were you a servant of sin, you were still a slave at one time, but you've been set free. Now you're adopted into this family, and this family gets to stay. Heaven is a home that we get to live in forever, not just deliver the furniture. Isn't that an amazing thing? There's no separate line. I'm going to stand in a line which goes right up to what's called the mercy seat. And when I get up there, mercy is all there is. That means I don't get what I deserve. How am I going to say this? Again, I better watch what I say because it'll really get mean-spirited in a hurry, and I don't want to do that. I want to go on, just read one more verse. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. There's a lot of ways that people think they get free. They can run away. People escape. People get picked up. They go to jail. We have this show, I watch it every once in a while, on the History Channel called Great Escapes. Man, those people get away, and it's amazing the stuff they go through to get away. I'm going to tell you, a home in heaven, you never have to worry about escape. It's yours. The difference in the whole thing comes to the fact that if you escape from something, you're always looking back. You never know what's chasing you. Time will catch you, won't it? What's behind you comes forward. Christ is worried about from here that way. He's worried about moving on. And he says, if he sets you free, you're free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me because my word hath no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my father, and you do that which you have seen with your father. Oh, wow. Now that's getting just completely personal. Because he just told them, you know exactly what this world has you do, and that's who raised you. Wow. See, we don't realize sometimes how Jesus could be really snide. This is pointed. He said, you know, your father taught you how to sin. He taught you how to try to kill people. I've seen what my father did. He's provided a way. I've learned a lot of things in this world from a lot of people. Some good, some bad. But I have a Father in heaven. And that Father in heaven has only taught me things that were good. Isn't that amazing? He's taught me to be humble because I see how small I really am. He's taught me to be thankful because of what all he's done for me. I think it's Jimmy Dean that has that old... Anybody ever listen to Jimmy Dean? I'm not talking about the sausage. I'm talking about the guy that owned the sausage. You ever listen to Jimmy Dean? He's got this whole soliloquy where he sits and talks. And he's talking as an old farmer out in the field. And the farmer looks up and he looks around and everything's burned up and he's trying to hoe a bunch of worthless corn. And he says, Lord, a little bit of rain would sure be good. And he goes on and he says, you know, if I don't get some in that lower field down there, I'm going to lose that whole crop. Cow's probably going to go dry. And he goes on through how bad things really are. And then the old man stops and he says, but Lord, don't think I ain't appreciative. Boy, we had a good-looking young bull calf last week. We really needed that. We sure appreciate the fact that you give us a new grandson. He's a big, healthy kid. Thank you for that. And he goes through this whole thing and he said, now, don't ever want to sound like I'm just griping. But if you can see fit to do one more thing for me, a little rain. But if it don't, you knew what you were doing anyway, I guess. I'll let somebody else bug you. Talk to you later. Boy, that's how we ought to see God. We ought to say, God, I need this. But boy, look all you've already given me. That's what sets you free when you stop and you think, I don't just need something else. I ought to be thankful for what I already got. I know what God has already done for me. He set me free. That free is a free that nobody can ever take away. Most people don't realize there's a book that's called Pilgrim's Progress. Somebody in here has probably read it. Behind the Bible, the Pilgrim's Progress is the second most read book in the history of mankind. It's about a guy who was going to be a pastor, but didn't have a license from the government and was thrown in jail. It's kind of the way it works. Then he writes an entire book. He actually wrote two or three. But Pilgrim's Progress is just how he went from being a sinner to proclaiming the gospel, and how proclaiming the gospel has cost him so much. But it's the way it works. Pilgrim's Progress. He looked back and he said, that's what I was, this is what I am. Most everybody here has heard the song Amazing Grace. Oh, come on, everybody's asleep. Amazing Grace. John Newton was all involved in all that. He wrote that looking back on a lifetime. He was a slave trader. He was, in his own words, he was one of the worst people that ever walked on the planet. But God saved him. God asked him to proclaim my gospel. And he did it not only through word, but through songs too. And he wrote Amazing Grace. That's what saved his soul. A wretch. And he meant it. We sing it now and don't think about it. What is in my past? I'm proud that I was born an American. I'm proud I was born in America. I'm proud that I was born when there was such a thing as air conditioning coming shortly. Now, we didn't have it, but it was on its way. I mean, I can remember as a kid. How many of you, and I'll have you tell your ages, how many of you were a kid and you remember going to the grocery store because it had air conditioning? Oh, man. I love going to the grocery store because we didn't have air conditioning. We had box fans in every window, and you just stayed next to the shade, and we slept with our head pillow in the window so you'd get in the shade. We'd go to the grocery store, and I mean, I hated the grocery store except it's hot summertime. And you go in there, and it's just so cool. Who remembers that? Yep. Golly, people don't want to say nothing today. Here's the deal. I then got air conditioning. Me and Charlotte got married, and we hadn't been married too long when I got us a little old window air conditioner. Wow! That's the greatest thing since they sliced bread. I mean, I don't just have to tear it off anymore. That's good stuff. Folks, I'm proud of that kind of stuff, and I poke fun at it. But I'm proud of the fact that I didn't live in the good old days. Because the good old days wasn't all that good. Indoor plumbing. It's a great thing. Our church didn't have indoor plumbing. We had a two-holer out back. And we were proud of two holes. And then they had a two-holer on the opposite side. You go out to Pleasant Grove, Carl, and they still got a... They got one holer on each side. They're not quite as big time as what my family was. We had two holes on both sides of it. Folks, are you appreciative of what you've got? You look back and you say, man, look what I got. God's done so much for us, and all we want is something else. We just want one more thing. Lord, would you just do one more thing? What I've got ain't good enough. My goodness, I've got a vehicle out there, and when I hit the starter, it usually starts. Now, every once in a while it don't, and then you got to work on it, right? You put it in gear, you drive where you're going to go. I don't have to ride a sweaty, nasty horse. And I know everybody, there's probably horse lovers in here. I'm sorry, but you must not have been raised around the ones I was. I'm officially a horse hater. I'm not a horse lover, I'm a horse hater. Or maybe it's just the ones I was raised around. But folks, I got a car now. Anybody here ever rode in a buckboard? My dad and Eldon Hudlow used to build the things. We'd go over and get on those and just ride all over the countryside. They'd bounce you to death. I don't like that. I like to get in my car. I turn on the air conditioner. My car don't smell like a sweaty old horse. Folks, I'm just saying all that. I'm not even trying to be funny. I'm telling you, start thinking about what God's already done for you. And first and foremost, He set you free. If you're here and you know Him as Lord and Savior, you've been set free. Amen. You got a home in heaven and you're part of the family. You're going to inherit it. We're not going to argue over it. It's going to be plenty there for all of us. Boy, have you seen these fortunes that get argued over for generations? Man, I'm going to go in, and to be honest with you, I think every Christian marching in, when we go into heaven, it's going to be, don't care where I'm staying. Everybody, oh, I'm going to have this and I'm going to have that. You ain't going to care. You're going to be in the presence of God. That Jesus Christ is going to be right there. That's going to be a home in heaven. That's what He made you free to become. We're going to be part of that inheritance. Everything that He's done for me up to here, I'm tickled to death. I really am. And we as Americans have got a lot to be proud of. And there's been a lot of people that have had to bleed and die for us to have it. So start wondering more about how good's it going to be, and a lot less about how bad have I got it. Things have been bad at times. I made my kids all memorize a certain line. I had to memorize it. They did too. They ain't no better than me. Sit in front of the TV, you watch the presidential debates. It was part of our family. Now, you better agree with what one particular person said, no matter what, or you better keep your mouth shut. But you got the Politicians only say certain things, at least till now. For 200 and something years, politicians would say taxes are bad, families are good, and the future's ahead of us. That is all they said, and I will dare you to go back and watch any debate up until the last 20 years. And all at once they're trying to tell us what we ought to think, and they're trying to tell us who we ought to be part of, and they ought to tell us what we ought to accept this. And not one time have I ever had any of them, I've never heard any of them say, what we need to accept is the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior. What they want you to accept is something that's exactly the opposite. Over and over. We want you to accept abortion. Now, let me get into that, and I'll make somebody mad over that one, but I'll just say it. That's not even a word. It's called murder. That's what it's called. I'm sorry. That's what it is. It's murder. It's not abortion. And it's not a health choice. See, if I believe that was a health choice, because they say, oh, this is about women's health. Sorry, ladies, that's not about your health. If that was the case, then every time that Kelly got on my nerves, I'd kill him. Just stop and think about that. Have you ever been around him? No. See, my blood pressure goes up when stupid people start talking. I'm not talking about Kelly anymore. See, I watch those politicians and my blood pressure goes up, and if I had to be around them very long, I'd be all upset. I'd die of a heart attack. It would be in my best health choice if I could just kill one of them. That would save me trouble. Is that not the exact same thing they're saying? Now, I'm gonna stand here and finish the conversation, because my wife and I were absolutely hit in the face with that 32 years ago. Whenever Charlotte found out she was pregnant with that one, we had a doctor come right straight in and say, you're going to have an abortion. Now, after I pulled Charlotte off of him, which is the truth, I got him out the door and he said, what is your wife's problem? And I said, my wife's problem is you just ask her to kill a baby. And he said, you can't be one of those people that believe that stuff. I said, yes, we are. He said, well, you better talk to her, because that baby's not going to be right. Now, we see now she's probably not. But but truth be known, she's healthy enough, folks. I mean, we're all proud of her. No, come on, that's funny. She's actually heard that one 1,000 times, haven't you? The doctor was right. He couldn't believe that Charlotte wouldn't have an abortion, because all these different, she went through chemo, and she was taking chemo pills whenever she come up pregnant with Amanda. And they said, she's 5 months pregnant, she's taking this chemo, there's no way that baby's right. There's going to be all kinds of problems. We found a different doctor. And 4 months later, we had a baby. It was healthy. That doctor didn't have any clue what he was talking about. But Charlotte told me all that time, I don't care if I do die having this baby. That's the way this is. That's the way we ought to see it. God's in charge of when you're going to die. If it's a health choice, don't get on my nerves. Just, I want you to go home and ponder on that one. Whenever they say health choice, that just bugs me to no end. You people are making me crazy. So for my better health, I think all you ought to be dead too. And I'm going to finish you with one of the most famous lines in the history of pro-life. One of the most famous lines is, everybody who's for abortion has already been born. They've already been born. It's not easy to say, you can't tell me this, I'm set free for something else. I was saved and set free. And I'm appreciative of everything God's given me, everything He does for me, I really am. But at the end of the day, I was set free for a home in heaven. What about you? Are you still a servant of sin? Or have you been set free? I'm going to ask the musicians to come forward. I probably get as frustrated as any human alive at our politicians. But you got to pray for them. I get frustrated at a lot of stuff, but I'm supposed to pray for it. So if you're here and you're proud to be an American, if you're a child of God and you're proud to be an American and you want to say thank you to God, while you're saying thank you for all your blessings, ask that He bless those people that are in charge. That's our duty. I didn't vote for half of them, but I'm going to pray for all of them. Because my Bible tells me that the better they do, the better we do. That's the way this works. Pray for the good of all those that have an office in this country. No matter what party they are, no matter how stupid they are. Pray for them. But if you're here and you don't know Him as Savior, is this all there is? See, there's never going to be an election in heaven. Never, because there's a King, and He's perfect. And our life, when we get there, will be right along with His, and it will be perfect. Let's look back and see what all He's done for us. Yes. How much has He blessed me? Absolutely, a lot. But what's even ahead is bigger, because I know Him and I've been set free. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Lord, I just ask that if there's any here this morning that don't know You as Savior, that haven't made that public profession of faith in You as Lord and Savior of their life, let this be the moment that they realize that only through You can they be free. Free from sin, free from all the burdens of this world. And Lord, help each one of us that do know You to just be appreciative for all You've brought us through already, and help us to look forward to a home in heaven. A home where we're going to be part of the ones that inherit that and live forever with You. And we just thank You so much that that is our future. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's all stand.
Have thine own way.